To everyone, amen, good morning. Let us all stand and let us sing together and sing song number 208, Great Grace Greater Than Our Sin. Amen.
Marvelous grace of our loving Lord, grace that exceed our sin and our guilt, yonder and on Calvary's mount at poured, there were the blood of the Lamb was spilled. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin. Sin and despair like the sea waves cold, threatened and so with infinite loss.
Amen, louder. Amen, ever sing.
Points to the refuge, the mighty.
On the chorus now.
Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse.
Amen.
Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin. Dark is the stain that we cannot hide. What can avail to wash it away? Crimson tide, whiter than snow you may be.
On the chorus now.
Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is good and blessed within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all.
On the last verse now.
Marvelous, infinite, matchless grace.
Amen.
Freely bestowed on who will believe. You that are longing to see His face, will you this moment His grace receive? Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin.
Lord God, our Father, we praise and thank you once again, dear Lord, for this great privilege that you have given to us as a church, dear Lord, to come together to offer you our praise, our thanksgiving, dear Lord, and to worship you in spirit and in truth. And thank you, dear God, for the grace that you have given to us, the marvelous grace, and the grace that sustains us daily in our life, dear Lord. We pray, dear God, for every part of our service today, from the singing to the giving of our gifts, into the preaching of your word, dear God. We pray, dear Lord, that you use these songs that will be sung, dear Lord, to encourage the hearts of people, dear God, and use the message, dear Lord, to speak to our hearts, to speak to the heart of the people, dear God, who doesn't know you yet as their Savior, dear Lord, and to speak to the Christians, so God, to be convicted, dear Lord, by your word. And I pray, dear God, that you, your may in every part of our service, that your name alone be lifted up, magnified, honored, and glorified, dear God. We pray, dear Lord, for your continuous leading to each and every one of us. Be with our pastor, dear Lord, as he preaches your word. I pray, dear God, that we use this word, dear God, to speak to us once again. And all these things we'd like to pray in us, in Christ's precious name. Amen.
Amen. One more song, song number 437, Battle Hymn of the Republic.
Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is sifting out the vintage where the crops have got a store. He at least the lethal lightning of his terrible sword. His truth is marching on.
All together now.
Glory, glory, hallelujah.
Amen, glory.
Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His marvelous marching on. I have seen him in the white fires of a hundred second comes. They have builded him an altar in the evenings to and down. I can read the righteous sentence by the demon flaring lamps. His day is marching
on the chorus now.
Glory, glory, hallelujah.
Amen.
Glory, glory, hallelujah.
Amen, hallelujah.
Glory, glory, hallelujah. His day is marching on. He has sounded forth that trumpet that shall never sound in vain. He is sifting out the hearts of men before his judgment seat. Oh, be sweet, my soul will answer him in jubil at my feet. Our God is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Our God,
amen. On the last verse now.
In the beauty of the lilies, Christ was born across the sea. With his glory in his bosom, that pictures you and me. And he died to make the holy, let us die to all be free. Why God is marching
all together now.
Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Our is marching on.
Amen. All glory and praise to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Good morning to each and everyone once again. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Amen. According to Psalms 122 verse 1. Can you please say to the person beside you, I'm glad that you are in church this morning. Amen. Praise and thank God for this privilege and opportunity given to us. We're glad to have our members here with us this morning. And of course, returning visitors and regular attenders are here worshiping with us once again, and we have already acknowledged our first-time visitors. So as we continue with our service, as we begin, I would like to ask everyone to please go around and shake one another's hand with your smile, and may I request our song leader to come lead us in singing our welcome song, Kay Kristo Lang Ang Tunay na Pag-asa.
Ay sa'yo'y ibibigay.
Everybody sing!
Bawi lahat iyong kalungkutan sa panghabang buhay si Kristo'y kasama. Nalangitan at sa piling ng Ama. Kay Kristo lang ang tunay na pag-asa. Tugoy binuhos niya upang mabuhay ka. Sarap at pasakit, usang dinanas, sugat sa puso mo'y binigyan ng lunas. Tunay ngang may pag-asa kay Kristo lamang. Kaya
Amen. Thank you so much to everyone once again. So I'd like to ask everyone now to please go back to our seats as we will be continuing now with our service. So once again, we want to praise and thank God for this privilege given to us. And aside from the people who are here in our church building this morning, we'd like to say good morning as well to the people who are joining us through our live stream worship service, especially those people who are regularly attending our live stream service. We really appreciate your presence with us every Sunday. And we just want to ask and request to you that if you are blessed by the message, blessed by the singing, and blessed by the service, that you also would share the link of this live stream to your loved ones so that they will also get the opportunity and privilege to hear the gospel of salvation. So as we continue with our service this morning, we have prepared some special music that we hope and pray will encourage each and everyone's hearts this morning. So I would like to call now our trio men to come and sing.
Approaching when the souls of men will hear a mighty shout resounding in the sky. In power and great glory, King Jesus will appear and take his children home to paradise. It will be a celebration for the ones who chose his name, but not all separation for the ones who turned away. Are you ready for the trumpet? Are you ready for the call? Soon the angels will assemble to usher in the Son of God. Come and find you faithful. Will he know your name at all? Every moment brings us closer. Are you ready for the call?
The Bible speaks of two men who are standing in the field, where one is taken and one is left behind.
Two women in the kitchen, one goes and one remains. So get your house in order while there's time. The cross, there is salvation. To the blood, there is a way to secure your destination on the resurrection day. Are you ready for the trumpet? Are you ready for the call? Soon the angels will assemble to usher in the Son of God. Will he come and find you faithful? Will he know your name at all? Every moment brings us closer. Are you ready for the call? There's an urgency to reach the world. We have no time to wait, for within the heart the call, so the angels will
to reign, the Son of God. Will he come and find you faithful? Will he know your name at all? Every moment brings us closer. Are you ready for the call?
To you, man, for that song. It is a song of warning and a song of encouragement as well. And it says in there, are you ready for the trumpet? Are you ready for the call? And I hope that each and every one of us can truly answer that question. And I hope that when the time comes, we never know when the time will come, but when the time comes, may we ask our questions. Will he find us faithful? Will he know our name? And if you are somebody today who is in doubt that God doesn't know your name, may the message today will give you an assurance of that salvation, the salvation that only can be found through Jesus Christ. And for us Christians, may it be a great reminder to us to always heed to the great commission of God, to always reach out to the people, because we should always be ready, and especially if we have loved ones today that who doesn't know Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior. One can go, one can remain. I hope that we are the ones who will go, not the ones who will remain. So thank you so much for that song. So as we continue our service, may I call now our ushers to please come for our offertories. So as a reminder, once again, each and every one of us of our tithes, sacrificial giving, and commitments. So if you want to give through cash or check, ask our ushers to the yellow envelope they are giving. And if you want to give through e-transfer, you can still do it. And send it to mbbctoronto@yahoo.ca. And everything that will be given will be used for the ministry and for the furtherance of the gospel. So ushers, please come. And may I request Brother Anton to come and pray for the offering.
May I request everyone to please stand? Okay, let's pray. Lord Heavenly Father, once again, we want to praise and thank you, Lord, for bringing us here today to worship you in spirit and in truth. And Lord, I pray, Lord, for the tithes and offerings, Lord, that we may give back what is due to you, Lord. And I pray, Lord, for the preacher today, Lord, that we may see you in his words, Lord, and may you find us faithful with our worship, Lord. And in all of these things, we ask in Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
Amen. Let us all stand again as we sing song number 221, A Child of the King. Amen. Let us sing first, second, and last stanza.
My father is rich in houses and lands. He holds that the wealth of the world in his hands. Of rubies and diamonds, of silver and gold, his coffers are full. He has riches untold. I'm a child of the King, a child of the King, with Jesus my Savior. I'm a child of the King. My Father's own Son, the Savior of man, once wandered on earth as the poorest of them, but now he is pleading our pardon on high, that we may be his.
Amen.
When he comes by and by, I'm a child.
Ever sing.
A child of the King, with Jesus my Savior, I'm a child of the King.
On the last verse now.
A tad or a cat is why would I care? They're building a palace for me.
Amen.
Though every from home, yet still I may sing, oh glory to God, I'm a child of the King, I'm a child of the King, a child of the King, with Jesus my Savior, I'm a child of the King.
Amen. Please be seated.
Bye.
Amen. The Lord Jesus Christ is mine, and He is yours too. You have trusted Him in your heart as your personal Savior. I'm glad I walked today in this church, as my message is the Christian's walk with God. Now, how many of you read your Bible every day? Don't raise your hand, because I'm sure I'm not going to see everyone raise their hand. Answer that in your hearts. And how many of you, if you are among the few that read their Bible every day, how many of you would sometimes go for the next chapter because what you're reading is so interesting and you just want to know what's going to be next? How many of you love the part where they talk about numbers or genealogies? How many of you sees the pattern in some parts where the Bible talks about genealogies? And, you know, I would sometimes look at the pattern and do speed reading because they say the same thing. The only thing different is the name and sometimes the years of how long they live. And I feel guilty doing that because my brain tells me that that's just the way it goes. You know, we should read every word of the Bible. Amen. And I believe the Bible is God's perfect book, and that's the way it's written. It holds a perfect pattern and a perfect reason why it's written that way. Just like in real life, we should never be caught up in the seeming monotony of life, but expect something unique, different, and exciting would come up. Okay? Just like when the Bible describes in detail the tabernacle or the temple or heaven, God is telling us that He is attentive to all the details of everything, including our lives. One reason why God would write down every detail on how the tabernacle or the temple or heaven is built, it's because God wants to tell us that He is particular with details. And if God is particular with all the details, then we should too about the details of our lives. You know, we should not approach Christian life as a whole. You know, and you know, you just don't go to the very details of it. Like when you say you love God, that's very general. Question is, how do you love God? You know, when you go to the details of that statement, I love God, that's where you need to focus on the many details. Amen? I believe that God is particular with the details of your life. He's particular about how you spend the day. Did you pray this morning? Did you read your Bible this morning? How was your thought about coming to church today? Were you excited? Were you delighted? So I do believe that God is interested in the details of our lives. And sometimes you might think it's monotonous. From time to time, God gives something unexpected. And today's gonna be different because my text to you is 32 verses. We're gonna read 32 verses today before I preach. Amen. Just to prove something to you. And that's gonna be where I'm gonna focus on. So if you have your Bibles, and you should, Genesis chapter 5. Now, Genesis is the first book of the Bible. Amen? If you still don't know. Genesis chapter 5, verse 1 to 32. Basically, the whole chapter. Amen? Genesis chapter 5. Shall we all stand up, please? I'm just going to read. You read with your own eyes, okay? So, the whole chapter. How about that? Amen? This is the book of the generation of Adam in the day that God created man. In the likeness of God made he him. Male and female created he them and blessed them and called their name Adam in the day when they were created. And Adam lived 130 years and begot a son in his own likeness after his image and called his name Seth. And the days of Adam, after he had begotten Seth, were 800 years, and he begot sons and daughters. And all the days that Adam lived were 930 years, and he died. And Seth lived 105 years, and begot Enos. And Seth lived, after he begot Enos, 807 years, and begot sons and daughters. And all the days of Seth were 912 years, and he died. And Enos lived 90 years, and begot Canaan. And Enos lived, after he begot Canaan, 815 years, and begot sons and daughters. And all the days of Enos were 905 years, and he died. And Canaan lived 70 years, and begot Mahalalel. And Canaan lived, after he begot Mahalalel, 840 years, and begot sons and daughters. And all the days of Canaan were 910 years, and he died. And Mahalalel lived 65 years, and begot Jared. And Mahalalel lived, after he begot Jared, 830 years, and begot sons and daughters. And all the days of Mahalalel were 895 years, and he died. And Jared lived 162 years, and he begot Enoch. And Jared lived, after he begot Enoch, 800 years, and begot sons and daughters. And all the days of Jared were 962 years, and he died. Take note of this. And Enoch lived 65 years, and begot Methuselah. And Enoch walked with God, after he begot Methuselah, 300 years, and begot sons and daughters. And all the days of Enoch were 365 years. And Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him. And Methuselah lived 187 years, and begot Lamech. And Methuselah lived, after he begot Lamech, 782 years, and begot sons and daughters. And all the days of Methuselah were 969 years, and he died. And Lamech lived 182 years, and begot a son. And he called his name Noah, saying, "This same shall comfort us concerning our work and toil of our hands because of the ground which the Lord had cursed." And Lamech lived, after he begot Noah, 595 years, and begot sons and daughters. And all the days of Lamech were 777 years, and he died. And Noah was 500 years old, and Noah begot Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, be with us now, dear God, as we look upon your holy word and understand, dear God, what it is, what it means, dear Lord, to walk with you. And may we as Christians, dear Lord, walk with you. And if we have not started, dear God, I pray that each and every one today will start their walk with God. May you be honored, glorified, magnified in our midst today. All the saints who pray and ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. I intentionally chose for us to read verse 1 to verse 32 for you to see the seemingly monotony of this chapter. But, like I said, from time to time, you know, when it seems like life is one big monotonous cycle, God, out of the blue, brings something new, surprising, and exciting. If you look intently at the verses while you're reading the same, seemingly same things over and over again, there's something that was different. All the names that were mentioned at the end, it says right here, and he died. Adam, in verse 5, he died. Amen? Seth, in verse 8, he died. Enos, and so on and so forth, all the names mentioned here died except one. And who is that? Enoch. Enoch, the Bible says right here, starting in verse 18. And Jared lived 162 years, and he begot Enoch. And Jared lived, after he begot Enoch, 800 years, and he begot sons and daughters. And all the days of Jared were 962 years, and he died. Now here's where the monotony is somehow broken. Verse 21, and Enoch lived 65 years and begot Methuselah. And Enoch walked with God after he begot Methuselah 300 years and begot sons and daughters. And all the days of Enoch were 365 years. I'm expecting now that the Bible will say, and Enoch died. But no. Verse 24. This is one surprising break in what seemingly is a monotonous chapter. Verse 24, and Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him. No mention of Enoch dying. He had that walk with God. But God said, he's not going to experience death. I'm just going to take him. It must be an interesting kind of a walk. Amen. It must be so great a walk that God said, you don't have to die. I'll just take you. Here we see names of people whose description in life on how they live, they got sons and daughters and died. This is pretty much the same as the life of many people. He lived, he got sons and daughters, and then died. But Enoch is different. You know, anyone, each and every one of this can say that he lived, he got sons and daughters, and he died. That could be your epitaph. Amen? But Enoch's epitaph or gravestone would be different. What would be inscribed in Enoch's tomb is, walked with God, and he was not, and was not, or God took him. Amen? But the most important thing about Enoch is that he walked with God. We might not be just like Enoch. God will take it with us and not experience that. But hey, if the Lord Jesus Christ comes before we die, we're not going to experience death. Amen? We're all just going to be like Enoch. The Lord Jesus Christ will take us home. But if not, I hope that in our gravestone, we can write these words, born into this world, live for God, home with Christ. Amen? So my children know what to put in my tombstone. Amen. Born into this world, live for God, home with Christ. So there's one character in this genealogy that broke the monotony of living and dying. And that is a man who walked with God. Hey, listen. The only way we can break the monotony of this life is to walk with God. Something so important to God that we ought to walk with Him. How many years did Enoch walk? Huh? Verse 22. Look. And Enoch walked with God after he begot Methuselah 300 years. And here are some Christians who have not been a Christian for 30 months and they want to quit. Here we have Christians who have not been a Christian for 3 years and they want to quit. Enoch walked with God for 300 years, folks. Never once drifting away from his presence. He walked consistently with God. How long are you going to walk with God? I'm happy you're here. Huh? Because some of you will not be here after many years. Is that a fact, Pastor? Yes. There's just some people who will just be in church for a while, they'll go. Why is that? Why? Because they're not walking with God. It is important for us Christians to walk with God. It will break the seemingly monotonous life that you have. It will make your life exciting if you'll just walk with God. So let's walk with God. What kind of walk will that be? Number one, a walk pleasing to God. a walk pleasing to God. Sometimes your walk that is limping can be the kind of walk that is pleasing to God. Amen? God doesn't need your walk like you're walking on a ramp, showing off your vanity, ladies. Huh? If my knee is not hurt, I'll show you how. I leave that up to some other day. That's not the kind of walk that God wants. The Lord doesn't want or need your proud look or walk. You walk like you have a stiff neck. And everybody is below you. God doesn't need that walk. Amen? God wants a walk that is pleasing to God. Hebrews 11:5. By faith, Enoch was translated that he should not see death and was not found because God had translated him. For before his translation, look at this, he had this testimony that he pleased God. That's the kind of walk that Enoch had. And that's why the Lord took him. The kind of walk that Enoch walked in his life for 300 years is a walk that is pleasing with God. His walk with God was a testimony of his life. He pleased God. Tonight, Christians, whom are we pleasing? Huh? I don't want this church because the pastor preached so long. I don't want MBBC to run because the pastor yells, it's so loud. I don't like it. I don't like the chair. It's not soft. Now it's soft. I don't like the floor. It's not carpet. We'll carpet it for you this coming Sunday. I don't want to go to your church. You have to walk up the stairs. I'll follow up the landlord to fix the elevator. So many things that won't satisfy, you know, what your standard of pleasure is. Hey, we're not here in church to be pleased. We want to walk with God, a kind of walk that pleases God, not ourselves. I don't want your church because there's so many snub. How about you? Are you not a snub? I don't like your church because you speak Tagalog, of course, Filipinos. But try to speak English. Amen. We're in Canada. We're not in Cebu. Huh? We're not in Bicol. We're in Canada. Speak English. Amen. But we don't live this life just for pleasure. Our main concern should be to please God, not men. You come to church not because pastor will look for you. Hey, you come to church because God will be looking for you. And God is expecting you to be in church to give him back the glory and praise and honor and thanksgiving. When we please God, you know, there's something about pleasing God. You don't have to please men. Please God first. And when you please God, somehow, man is pleased with you.
I look at Proverbs 16:7.
When a man's ways please the Lord, he maketh even his enemies to be at peace with him. So don't aim to please man. Please the Lord. And when you do so, people will like you for living a life that is pleasing before God. The way to compromise is when man pleases man more than God. We have compromising churches. We have compromising pastors. You know what? Why are they so? Because they want to please men. They compromise. They go soft on sin. You know? And their message is restricted. The deacon, the biggest giver will tell, Pastor, you're so, you know, just tone it down a little bit.
Huh? You come to me and say that, here's what you're going to get. Because I take my orders from God. Bible says, preach the whole counsel of God. Preach in season, out of season. And no man can tell me. I'm going to preach about the birth of Jesus Christ in December. Amen? I don't care if he was not born in December. I'm just going to preach the fact that he was born here on earth as a man. Amen? The way to compromise is when man pleases man more than God. How did Enoch please God? By faith. Let's read the next verse. Hebrews 11:6. Hebrews 11:6. Huh? No? Okay. Hebrews 11:5. Ano sabi doon? Sorry. Yeah. Hebrews 11:6. Open your Bible to Hebrews 11:6. How did Enoch please God? Hebrews 11:6. But without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Now, how are we going to please God? By faith. Christians, let's live by faith, not by sight. The reason why some Christians are afraid, are not coming to church on Sunday because the bosses tell them you have to work on Sunday and they're afraid to lose their job. They're out there somewhere making money, afraid of the future that they're going to lose. That's not walking by faith. Amen? I appreciate some Christians who would give a testimony, Pastor, I turned down a job that will prevent me from worshiping God. What is that? That is by faith, that God will give them a better job. Some Christians don't want to exercise faith. Here's the job. It's a nice paying job. Take it. It might not come again. Hey, with God, it will come again. In a better way, in a better form. That is living by faith. Some Christians just don't want to exercise faith. They are afraid to exercise faith. Why? Because they look at God as a small God. Hey, God is bigger. God is great. He will never leave you nor forsake you. He will take care of you. The Bible says, just seek him first, and all these things will be added unto you. The reason why some Christians don't want to give is because they are afraid that they're not going to have enough for themselves. Explain that to me, Pastor. I don't know. Because it's God who does it. I don't know that if you give to God, that you still have more. I don't know. Don't ask me. It's not me who provides. It's God. I just also rely on him and trust him by faith. All I need to do is obey him. Walking with God and pleasing God go hand in hand. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 1. Furthermore, then we beseech you, brethren, and exhort you by the Lord Jesus, that as ye have received of us how ye ought to walk and to please God, walk and please God, so ye would abound more and more. Hey, Christians, walking with God and pleasing God, walk hand in hand. And the only way we can please God is by faith. It was testimony that he carried on for 300 years. During the time that men lived a long life. Yeah, because the air is pure, right? Different condition then than now. But that's for a different lesson. Amen. It was a testimony of a consistent walk. It was not interrupted by any events in life. Many times we Christians, we are so easily disrupted in our walk with God, in the things that we do for God, in our devotions, how easy it is for us to abandon our devotions. All of a sudden, you became busy, you forget reading your Bible. So easy for us to be disrupted in our service. You know, I chance upon, every time I look at our albums, our pictures, I did that the other day because Brother Lawson was asking me for some pictures. And he wants to put it in the flyer. And so I look for pictures. And every time I would go back and look for pictures, I see pictures of some members who were here before and are not here now. And it saddens me to see those Christians come and go. No faithfulness, no loyalty. They go wherever the tide brings them. You know, sa Tagalog po, inaanod. Huh? If you know how to swim, you can go against the tide. If you're alive, you can go against the tide. If you're dead, what? You go along the flow. But are you a dead Christian? Or are you an alive Christian? So you can swim against the tide of this world. How many of us are so easily interrupted in our service for God? Huh? You used to sing in the choir here, and now no more. You used to go out and win souls, and now no more. Probably you have looked yourself as something on a higher position now. Huh? Nobody goes here in a high position that you're not going to do what you used to do for the Lord. Amen? If God is blessing your life, the more you should humble down and do the things that we have always been doing for the Lord. How easy it is for us to be disrupted in our giving. Amen? You may say, well, no, I'm married now, Pastor. I have a lot of things to take care of. I have kids now, Pastor. I have... Why hindi ka na nag-asawa? Na-distrupt pa yung ano mo, giving mo sa Panginoon. How easy it is for us to get distracted in the things that we do for God. Sometimes I see young ladies who are faithful until somebody courts them. Huh? A young man that is so faithful to God, doing service for the Lord until he finds someone to court. The affection has shifted from the Lord. So easily to be disrupted. How easily it is for our worship to God to be disrupted. No consistency. Let's learn from Enoch. Amen. Walk with God consistently so that we can have a walk that is pleasing to God. You got married, single men and women, and now you're not as faithful as you were before, then you, I think, that's the wrong kind of marriage. You better make it right. Amen? Better make it right. How? Come to God. You know, some people say this is a stage. Huh? You have a nice stage, Pastor. I don't want to look at it that way. I want to have a wide altar height here. Amen? I want as many people that are standing here to sing in the choir. It's the same number of people kneeling down here. That's what I want to see more. More kneeling people here in this altar than people standing in the stage. Amen? So that we can all be consistently walking with God and pleasing God in our lives. Enoch's testimony is a testimony of a continuing walk. There was no moments of backsliding or carnality. Until when will you be here? Ask yourself that question. What would it take you to be taken from the service of God? Will you also go like other Christians who have gone by the wayside? It was a testimony of a completed walk. Just like Paul, who completed this course. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 7, I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. What will it take you, Christians, to bow out of the fight? Huh? Keep on going. Amen. Consistently walk. Continue your walk. Complete your walk with God. Walking with God is living always in the presence of God. You know, when you walk with God, and when you walk with God, you're always with God. Amen? It is acknowledging God in everything. When you pray, you don't have to shout to pray because you say God is in heaven. No, you just whisper a prayer because Jesus Christ is close to you. He's just beside you. You know the story about that Pentecostal preacher? Huh? He lives next to a Baptist preacher. And the Pentecostal preacher, every morning he will go out of the balcony just the same time as the pastor is having his coffee in the balcony. And the Pentecostal preacher will say, in a loud voice, shouting to heaven, Lord! Bless me! Huh? Fill me! Every day. And so the Baptist pastor got fed up. Lord, don't fill him. He's got holes. You don't have to shout at him. He's with you. Just have a simple, consistent, constant walk with God. He is enjoying His fellowship and delighting in Him. You know, you understand sweet fellowship when you were young. How many of you here, when you were in elementary, you walked from school to your house and back and forth? I remember that. I remember walking in elementary. You know, I believe my walk is about 5 blocks. 5 blocks. Huh? Probably I would estimate that to be about 2 to 3 kilometers of walk every day. But I never felt or became aware of the distance. Why? Because every time I walk with my classmate. And we have nice fellowship together. Amen? What do you talk about? Nothing. Just stupid things. Amen? But the thing is, you have fellowship with that person. And when you walk, you don't mind the distance. And sometimes, you know, like I told you, I have a friend, we walk. And I would go past my house, and I would walk to his house. You know? And that is a disadvantage to me. I walk more than you. So, you know what he would do? He would walk halfway. So, we're equal. We walk the same distance. That was our agreement. Amen. I just wanted time to spend with my friend and have fellowship with him. Hey, Christians, how many of us enjoy our walk with God? How many of us enjoy our fellowship with the Lord Jesus Christ? every single day of our lives, I hope you would. Amen? It is communicating with Him and Him communicating with us. When I was in college, I studied in UP, in Diliman. When I was, the College of Arts and Sciences is in this building. College of Engineering is in this building, And right in the middle is like a mini forest. And they cut across the forest. They cut across. You can only walk. No cars can go in there. So I every day from the College of Arts and Sciences, I would walk to the College of Engineering and back and forth. I would walk. I would sing. I would talk to God. Just like a crazy person. And cell phone is not yet invented at that time. Yeah. So today I see a lot of people talking. Right? And they have the earphones in their ears. But during that time, there's no cell phone yet, there's no earphone yet. You would see me opening my mouth and talking. Who am I talking to? I'm talking to God. And I enjoy that walk. Every day. That's my daily walk with God. Literally. That's my literal walk with God. I walk with Him every day. I talk to Him about my problems. Lord, I have a terror teacher. Please help me. You know those terror teachers, right? I walk with him. I just talk to him because he's just next to me. I would sit next to the window. I would look at the window and say, Lord, help me with this exam. I need to pass this exam. Just like that. Why? Because I'm walking with God every day. I don't have to wait to go home to talk to God. I can talk to God wherever I am. You know why? Because I'm walking with God every day. It is communicating with Him and Him communicating with us. So, what kind of walk it is? Number one, a walk listening to God. Secondly, a walk with a purpose from God. A walk with a purpose from God. God wants us to walk with Him. Why? Because He has a purpose. You see, the reason why God created men is God wants to have fellowship with men. Amen? And man, because he chose to sin and disobey God, broke that fellowship. And now the Father wants to restore the fellowship. He sent His Son, Jesus Christ, so that you and I can be restored back to the Father. And here you are now. You're a child of God. You're still not fellowshipping with the Father. The purpose why God saved us is for us to have fellowship with Him every day. To talk to God as His children. Amen? You new parents, you enjoy talking to your kids, your babies. Am I correct? Dima? You baby talk them and they look at you. What is he talking about? Why is he talking that way? But you enjoy it. You enjoy talking to your babies even if they don't know how to talk or don't understand what they're saying. But you love to. Amen? And that's the reason why God created man. He wanted to have fellowship with man. God restored that fellowship, and yet some Christians don't walk with God every day. There's a purpose for God. We see many charity events like Walk for a Cause. Enoch's walk with God was with a heavenly cause. The Bible says his walk in Hebrews 11:5, his walk is a testimony of his life. Hey, Christians, your life and my life is a testimony of us being Christians. Amen? It is not so much a testimony of what you do in life. It's not a testimony, much of a testimony that you are a doctor or an engineer or a nurse. It's much of a testimony that you are a Christian. More than anything else, people should know that you are a Christian. Amen? Some of you have your Facebook account. What do people know of you? Anybody who looks at my wall, anybody who looks at my wall will immediately know that I am a Christian. No doubt about it. Every time I receive a friend request. How many of you receive friend requests? Oh, plenty. And some with some women who are half naked. And you immediately accept without thinking. Every time I get a friend request, because there are some people who will make friends with you so that they can sell you things, right? So what I would do first is I look at the profile, the about, or I look at the posts. I scroll down, and if I see something that's not good, I just reject it. Amen. And the thing I ask is, this a Christian? Is this a Baptist? If I would like to be friends with Baptists and Christians, I would look. And some of them are Baptists, but you will never see in their profile that they are one. So if I don't see it, I just delete. Because people will do that for different reasons. Amen? God wants us to walk with Him because God has a purpose why He wants us to walk with Him. You know, Enoch was the first of four generations of preachers. Did you know that? Enoch was the first of four generations of preachers in Jude chapter 1. Let's look at this. And Enoch also, the seventh from Adam, prophesied of this, saying, "Behold, the Lord cometh with 10,000s of his saints to execute judgment among all and to convince all that are ungodly among them of all their ungodly deeds which they have ungodly committed." That's the reason why. "And all of their hard speeches which ungodly have spoken against him." That's the reason why the Lord allowed Enoch to be translated with God. Amen? His life was a testimony foreshadowing or looking forward to how God will bring Christians with Him in the rapture. And so, his life was an example, a testimony of how we Christians should walk with God in anticipation of the coming of Jesus Christ. You know, why God wants to save you, right? God wants to bring you to heaven, to be with Him forever, right? If you're saved, you're going to heaven. If you have trusted Jesus Christ as your Savior, you're going to heaven. But is that the only purpose why God saved you? If that is the only purpose that God saved you, then we must all be in heaven the moment we got saved. Amen? But why are we still here? Because we need to live a life of testimony so that others would know Him too. And how do we do that? By walking a life that is worthy of a child of God. Walking in fellowshipping with God. A walk that is pleasing to God. Enoch walked with God because he knew what would come. Again, with Enoch. Enoch named his son Methuselah. You know who Methuselah is? Huh? Yeah, that's what you know about Methuselah. The oldest man in ever lived. 969 years. But that's not what's best about the name Methuselah. Enoch named his son Methuselah. And Methuselah means to bring death through the flood. Methuselah means to bring death through the flood. Or to bring, just simply to bring death. Look at that. In verse 32, in chapter 32, it ended with Noah, right? So you can find here that Enoch's life is, you know, it's all about God's plan and God's purpose. You know, Christians, our lives are to be lived according to the purpose of God, the plan of God, that there comes a time the Lord will take us home to heaven. God's plan for man is that man gets saved, and when he dies, he goes to heaven. Our lives must be aligned to that purpose, that when people see us, they see God's plan. Amen? Yeah, church is not just to attend church. Church is not just to be here on Sunday. It's about life, a life that is lived for the purpose of God. What purpose? God's purpose for every man. Methuselah was a reminder that judgment is coming. Methuselah was also of God's mercy and compassion. Noah was 600 when the flood came, and that is when Methuselah died. Not a coincidence. Everything is in the plan of God. Amen? Methuselah's name is to bring that. He died when Noah, or when the flood came. And that was when Noah was 600 years old. And then Enoch's walk with God is God telling us to walk with him till he comes. Enoch walking with God is God telling us to walk also with him till he comes. The Bible talks of faithfulness until he comes again. The Bible says, occupy till I come. Amen? Occupy till I come. We are not to forsake the assembling of ourselves as we see the day approaching, all in anticipation of the coming of Jesus Christ. Our faithfulness to the church is in anticipation of the coming of Jesus Christ. We are not to forsake the assembling. We are to be like Enoch as God. We await God taking us away to be with him. It's a life that is pleasing to God, a life, a walk with a purpose with God. We are to occupy till he comes and to always have oil in our lamps. So what kind of walk it is? First, a walk that is pleasing to God. Secondly, a walk with a purpose from God. And lastly, a walk into paradise with God. A walk into paradise with God. You know, if we walk in anticipation of the coming of Jesus Christ, we look forward to the day we are going to be with the Lord. Last night, church, I was crying in pain. And I said, Lord, if you're coming, it's fine with me. Where there will be no more pain, no more heartaches, no more disappointments. I'm going to be with the Lord forever. Hey, all of us are going to die someday. When are you going to reflect on eternity? Huh? Reflect on it now. Amen. You don't have to be old to think about life after this life. Because as far as I'm concerned, people die at any age. Amen? I invite you to go to a cemetery. You're going to find somebody there who was born in your age. In my case, 1980. No, sorry. 19... Wrong math. Sorry. Huh? Mental block. I challenge you, go to the cemetery, look at the day they were born. There will be somebody there who was born on the same year that you were born, but they're already there in the grave. You would find tombstones of babies, toddlers, young people, adults, old people. When are we going to reflect about our life after this life? Reflect on it now. Because you never know. You never know this life. Our life is just like a vapor, that's what the Bible says. So, a walk into paradise with God. So first of all, walk not in the way that leads to destruction. Now, I'm going to tell you about a kind of walk that we should not walk. Okay? Walk not in the way that leads to destruction. In Proverbs 4:12, the Bible says, there is a way that seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. So be very careful how you walk or where you walk. Okay? Or in the direction that you're walking. Do not walk the way of man's philosophy. In Colossians chapter 2, verse 8, beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit after the tradition of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after Christ. Beware. Because we have so many philosophies nowadays, so many false religion, it is not according to Christ. It is according to traditions of men. Okay? Make sure that you are walking in the right path, not the way of men's philosophy. Man has always defied the wisdom of God. Remember, the Tower of Babel is man defying God. Man trying to reach heaven on their own. That's the purpose. That's why they build the Tower of Babel. They want to reach heaven on their own efforts. We cannot be in heaven by our own efforts. Hey, we can only be in heaven through Jesus Christ. And you know what God did when they built the Tower of Babel? God confounded their language. Can you imagine that? One guy said, hey, bring me cement. And the guy at the bottom brought him bricks. You know? And everything was confounded. It was not completed. Man dispersed. Amen? Don't walk the way of men or the ways of men. Man's ways are opposed to God's way. Philippians chapter 3, verse 18 and 19. For many walk, of whom I have told you often, and now tell you even weeping, that they are the enemies of the cross of Christ. Verse 19, whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly, and whose glory is in their shame, who mind earthly things. Suppose to God's ways. The way of man ends in destruction. The way of man glorifies what is shameful. We're living in that age. The way of the world. Don't go the way of the world. In 1 John chapter 2, verse 15. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Verse 16. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. That's what social media is promoting. The lust of the eyes. Huh? That's why you see sexual things in there. The lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. All those material things and all those worldly things. Don't go the way of the world. Everything that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. Don't go the way of man's religion. Hey, you might say, well, Pastor, is the Baptist Church a religion? No, it's not a religion. Amen? What I am following is not religion. I have the Christian faith. 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 1. But there were false prophets also among the people, even as there shall be false teachers among you who privately shall bring in damnable heresies, even denying the Lord that brought them or bought them, and bring upon themselves swift destruction. So many false teachers nowadays. Huh? False prophets. False religion. I came from a false religion. Religion that follows tradition of men and does not follow the Bible. That religion has the tradition of men and the Bible, so-called. But when the tradition clashes with the Bible, they follow the tradition. That's why I left that religion. Amen? I realize it's not religion that will save you. It's your relation with Jesus Christ. The way of man's religion. We have so many unbiblical religion. I was telling my friend, you know, when we were talking, I told him, you have to remember this, you know, of all the many so-called religions today, Christian religion, okay, Christianity has so many different, what do you call that, variation or different different kinds of so-called Christianity. Judaism, I don't know how many kinds of Judaism there are. Islam, maybe just a few different options. So I told him, beware, because not all religion that say they are Christian are Christians. And some of them are cults. Right? Why are there so many so-called Christians? Why? Because the devil doesn't want you to find the truth. The devil makes it hard for you to distinguish which is the truth. Why is there so many Bible translations? Because the devil wants to divert you from the truth. Amen? And people will just say, well, you know, that's just different translation. This is not just translation, folks. This is the preserved word of God. And for the devil to pursue his deception, of course, the more versions there is, the more doubt to the King James Version. Am I correct? You know what they do in Philippine politics? The Philippines is the dirtiest politics of all. Huh? There are going to be candidates who will run for office, and he will pay two or three people to run. Are they real candidates? No. So that people will not pick the right one, he will spread the voters. And at the end, they will withdraw and they will get their votes to you. That's the tactic of the devil. I don't want people to know the truth. I'm going to have more translations of the Bible. I don't want people to know the right church. I'm going to have different kinds of so-called Christian churches. Aren't you surprised? Think. We have unbiblical religion. We have the enemies of the gospel religions. You know, these cults, you're drawing them away from the Bible. You think the followers of Kibloid read the Bible? No. They just rely on him, whatever he says. At the background, they say, amen, amen, amen. And they don't know that what he's saying is already opposed to the Bible. Ako nga, nasasabi natin ito, ayun yung umimin. We have so many humanistic religions today. And it's man, in essence, it is man that they are worshiping. It is man that they are pleasing. And lastly, I said it should be a walk into paradise with God. How do we walk into paradise with God? Walk in the way of God. Walk in the way of God. And how is that, Pastor? Simple. Walk with Jesus. Walk with Jesus. To walk with Jesus is to follow his footsteps. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 21, for even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that ye should follow his steps. Amen. Walk with Jesus every day of our lives. To walk with Jesus is to follow his footsteps. To walk with Jesus is to walk in the Spirit. Galatians chapter 5, verse 16, this I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. And lastly, walk in the way of God. How do we do that? Walk with Jesus. Secondly, walk in Jesus. There's a difference. Amen? Walk in Jesus. Colossians chapter 2, verse 6, as ye have therefore received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk ye in Him. Walk in Jesus Christ. Walk in Him. Why? Because Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life that leads to eternal life. John chapter 14, verse 1 to 3. I'm going to close with this. How do we walk with God? Walk with Jesus. But before you can ever walk with Jesus, you must first of all walk in Jesus Christ. Amen? You must be in Jesus Christ. How are we going to be in Jesus Christ? The Bible says, let not your hearts be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. Verse 2, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. Hey, Christians, we can walk with God. But before we can ever walk with God, we must first of all walk in Jesus Christ. You must be found in Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ must be in you. And how do we walk in Jesus Christ? How can we have Jesus Christ? Simply by making Him the Savior of your life. Jesus is the way. Make sure that you are in Jesus Christ. Today, you might be in your religion right now. You're holding on to that religion and hoping that your religion will bring you to heaven someday. Probably you have your own philosophy and way of thinking that, you know, for you to go to heaven. The Bible says there's only one way. Only one way. There's one way, and that way is Jesus Christ. Not the way of your religion, not even the Baptist Church. The Baptist Church is not the way. Amen? You're here in the Baptist Church for you to hear the truth and know about the way, which is Jesus Christ. There's only one way, and that is Jesus Christ. If you are in Jesus Christ, you're going to be in that way, and then you can walk with Jesus Christ. How can you be in Jesus Christ? Like I said, make Him today the Savior of your life. Make Him today, trust in Him, believe in Him as the Savior of your life. Believe in Jesus Christ as the way, the truth, and the life, because no man can come to the Father except by Jesus Christ. And how can you go to the Father through Jesus Christ? Simply make Jesus Christ the Savior of your life. He died for your sin. He shed His blood for you. And all you need to do is believe on what He did, that what He did on the cross was for you. Take it for yourself. Receive it as your own. Because the Bible says in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9, for by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. Not of works, lest any man should boast. Today, God is giving you the gift. Eternal life is a gift. It's not a reward. You know, I was telling my friend, I told him, you don't go to heaven because of what you have done. We go to heaven because of what Jesus has done. If for a moment you think you're going to heaven for what you have done, okay, you go to heaven for a moment, let's say that you go to heaven because of what you've done, the good things that you have done. So here you are in heaven with all the people who have done things for Him to go to heaven. What do you hear? The things that they have done to go to heaven. Huh? I have given this. I do this. I did that. I do this. I did that. If every day I'm going to hear those people telling me of what they did, that's not going to be heaven for me. Amen? Can you stand proud people? No. And there is no pride in heaven. That's why it doesn't make sense that you go to heaven by your own efforts. How do we go to heaven? By what the Father has provided for us. So that in heaven, the Father has all the glory. You know what the Father said? I will not share my glory to men. You cannot glory in heaven because of what you do, or you did, or what you have done. We can glory in heaven for what the Father has done. In that way, He has all the glory. And so it makes sense to me that I go to heaven not because of what I have done or accomplished, but because of what Jesus has accomplished. You will just acknowledge that in your heart today. Pastor, how do I walk in Jesus? How do I know that I'm saved? On my way to heaven because of Jesus Christ. Simple. Simply believe in Jesus Christ today. Trust Him as your personal Savior. And I'd like to invite you today, if you truly understood the message and you realize your need of Jesus Christ, why don't you open your heart? Call upon the name of the Lord. The Bible says, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Today you can call upon the name of the Lord by a simple act of prayer in your heart, believing in your heart. The Bible says, for with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Simply call upon the name of the Lord today and say, Lord, I want you to be the Savior of my life. I believe in what you did on the cross for me. You died on the cross, shed your blood, raised again on the third day, that I may be saved. That I put my faith upon. As simple as that. You can pray in your own words. Trust Jesus Christ today. Believe in what He did on the cross for you. And the Bible says, you're going to walk in Him. And then you can walk with Him. I hope today, those of you who are in this building, if you have not truly trusted Jesus Christ, if you have not truly accepted Him in your heart as your own personal Savior for what He did on the cross for you, I hope you'll do it now. So you can walk with God. Those of you who are watching through live streaming, may the Holy Spirit convict your heart today. So open your heart. Trust Jesus Christ today as your own personal Savior. Believe in Him. Believe in Jesus Christ for His sacrifice on the cross for you. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, this morning, we thank you, Lord, for this wonderful morning worship service, dear Lord, that you have allowed us to have, dear God, giving us strength to be in your house, Lord, to be together as one body, worshiping you, honoring you, and glorifying you, O God. And I pray to you, Lord, that the message of salvation, of having a walk with you, is something that every Christian now understands, that we have to walk with you every day of our lives. And I pray, O God, for those who have not known Jesus Christ, that they will walk in Jesus Christ and acknowledge that Jesus Christ is the only way to heaven. And for that, they will trust Jesus as their own personal Savior, believing that the sacrifice on the cross of Calvary was for the redemption of their sins. I pray to you, Lord, that the Holy Spirit will convict the hearts and people will be saved through this message of the gospel. And give you back all the praise and glory. Lord, I thank you for allowing me to preach this morning. May your name be lifted up and honored in our midst. For all these things, we pray in us. In Christ's most precious and holy name. Amen. Thank you so much for listening patiently and attentively. I just would like to request a 15 minutes of silence, as you know, some of our visitors may need to be shared with the gospel. And let's just respect that time. Amen. For 15 minutes. If you have any questions, you can also ask our members. Those of you returning visitors, or maybe Christians have questions, you can approach any of our members.
you have any questions, this is the time for you to raise those questions, and they will gladly answer you. Okay, so for 15 minutes.